With more than 500 cases of this mysterious lung illness from vaping, the question over the proposed vaping ban is where's that leading us? Where is the vaping ban? And again, every time we do a vaping story, they hate to say this, but I swear to God, there is a vaping cult out there. it's the craziest thing I've ever seen. When we talk about vaping, even though we talk about it's, you know, you got problems with THC, you got problems with C acetate, you got problems with heavy metals, you got problems with
pesticides.
With pesticides.
Yeah.
And it, when you talk about it, this cult mentality says, oh, we can't talk about that because it's safer than tobacco. Okay, let's say it's safer than tobacco. 500,000 people die every year because of tobacco. It doesn't move me to say it's a little bit safer. What's your take?
I think the vaping ban is a bad idea. And we know, you know, I know, everybody knows that, yes, the vaping companies are marketing these flavored products that they're trying to ban. They're marketing them to children. There is no question about that, and something should be done about that. But outright banning these things is an absolutely bad move. It's addressing a problem that's not related to the actual problem. The problem is you have hundreds of people getting ill. We don't know why. 9 people are dead.
And we don't know why. That's
right.
The point.
Because there's no regulations. That's the problem. There's no regulations in this industry whatsoever. We don't know what people are putting in here. The FDA does not have any kind of set standards as to what can go in a vape. Not to mention the little vape shops that pop up on the corners. They're putting God knows what in there because nobody's looking over their shoulders.
Is this just another FDA disaster?
Absolutely.
Okay, you've got an organization that is completely dysfunctional. If you believe the FDA is there to protect you, you are in la-la land. So the FDA watches this develop. Even in the early times, people are saying, look, there's no regulations. People can put whatever they want in here. They can have whatever device they want to deliver it. It can be something that's leaching lead into the human body, leaching pesticides into the human body, leaching C acetate in the human body, all these things. Now, I'm not suggesting, you know, we handled the tobacco litigation and we launched that case right at this law firm years ago. And we saw the documents, and I can tell you the stuff that's in tobacco is a lot worse than this. No question about it. But don't you get to the point where you want to say, look, yeah, we get that. It's a way for people to stop smoking, but we have to at least objectively talk about it. And the FDA has to regulate these mom and pop organizations that are making the delivery system, the pen.
Yeah.
They need to regulate every part of it.
Well, and people need to understand, too, anytime you're inhaling something into your lungs, don't you want to know what's in that? I mean, rather than take some guy behind the counter's word for it that, oh, no, I've just mixed up this fresh batch of it. No, that's what people are getting sick from. That's why this all happens suddenly. That's why people are dying. There's obviously a bad batch of something out there in this country killing people.
Let me tell you where this case goes. This is my prediction. In a couple of weeks, we'll be in Las Vegas where we have our meeting of lawyers that handle complex cases. And what we'll be talking about is this isn't a case that can be solved in one federal court. Okay, it may be brought in one federal court, but there's so many avenues to go after these companies. Take, for example, the pen itself. It's got all these component parts. Each one of those component parts are made in different states. You have so many components to it that you can almost pick where you want to bring the case. And so because of that, you're going to have these companies that are mom and pop organizations, basically hugely underfinanced, that are going to go under. Even the big companies are going to go under. And what we're going to find is when all the smoke clears, we're going to see most of this was financed by big tobacco. So we've come a full circle.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
Coming up, the Seed Charter School in Washington, D.C. is facing a lawsuit from grieving parents after the school did nothing to stop the bullying that led to their child's suicide. That and more when we come back. In 2018, a young student took her own life at the Seed Charter School in Washington, D.C. In a lawsuit filed earlier this year, the parents of the child alleged that the school did nothing to prevent the constant bullying their daughter suffered. And that's only the tip of the problem. That's the tip of the iceberg. It's only a small part of the story. Joining me to talk about this lawsuit and the information that's already been uncovered is attorney LaRuby May. LaRuby, let me, this case, it seems like over a period of the last 5 years, America's lawyer has done half a dozen of these stories. Okay. Child committing suicide in a setting where the people in control didn't have control. This is a charter school.
Yes.
And we already know all the fundamental problems with the charter school. Tell us this story, Luke. Just lay this out for the viewers.
You know, in January, on January 23rd, 2018, Stormaya Denson Jackson, 12-year-old, was at Seed Public Charter School, which is a boarding school in the District of Columbia. And that morning, Stormaya was found hanging in her dorm room.
What were the, as I looked at the background of this case, there were all of these warnings. Mm-hmm. That took place at the school. First of all, the psychiatrist that they had following her wasn't even a psychiatrist.
Wasn't licensed.
Unlicensed. They were a psychologist of sort, unlicensed. Mm-hmm. The child came out and said, I don't have any reason to live.
Yeah, no. So Stormaya expressed her suicide ideation to the people in charge, to the people that she was supposed to. And they brought her to the site, and as you mentioned, an unlicensed psychologist who did a suicide assessment on her and deemed her low risk. And so what we know right now is in the country, African-American children between the ages of 10 and 15 are one of the highest rates of increase of suicide.
So between what are the ages?
It's like between the ages of like 10 and 15, middle school age children, right? And the poorer you are, the economics play into it. And so when she came to the school, she was low risk. So when they did the suicide assessment, probably the most egregious nature of them doing the suicide assessment is as she exhibited suicide ideation, they did a survey on her and never notified mom of the suicidal ideation or that they even did a survey on the child.
Okay, here's where it gets really weird to me.
Okay.
There's laws mm-hmm. in D.C.
Yes.
And the laws are very clear,
very clear.
That a public school has to follow.
Mm-hmm.
If you see A, then you must do B.
Mm-hmm.
If you see B, you must do C.
Mm-hmm.
You must have licensed people
yes.
that are making estimations of whether this child's at risk.
Yeah.
That was thrown out the door
yep.
because this is a charter school.
Well, it was thrown out the door because this school is serving a population of poor black children. So that's why these things are thrown out the door. But in the District of Columbia, we have a law called the Youth Suicide Prevention Act. Because we know how many urban children are now committing suicide, in 2015, passed a law that says every teacher, everyone encountering our children must take suicide prevention training. And at Seed Public Charter School, prior to Stormaya's death, zero people, not a single person at the school, took the suicide prevention training, even though we have evidence of a case that's also pending against the school of another 12-year-old who tried to commit suicide prior to Stormaya.
Tell me, if you would,
mm-hmm.
give me how outrageous the conduct was of the school when people started asking questions.
So the school... I think we have to kind of go back not only of the conduct of the school, but of the authorizer, the charter school board of the school, that the school didn't do the training. The school didn't care to do the training. Like I said, we have evidence of another a pending lawsuit of a child maybe 6 months before Stormaya who attempted suicide. And even after that child in the school attempted suicide, still no one at the school felt that it was okay, that they needed to do suicide prevention training to make sure that their teachers or their psychologists were equipped.
What are the documents showing? If you just say, just give me, in every case like this, mm-hmm. Sometimes there's outrageous documents. And you mm-hmm. go, when a jury sees this,
yep.
they're going to be really angry.
Okay.
Does that exist?
Yeah, there's some document. I think probably the most outrageous document that's out there is Seed Public Charter School is authorized by the Charter School Board. And the executive director of the Charter School Board sent out an email that said, basically, when the law came out, the suicide prevention said, I'm not going to enforce it. I'm not going to penalize any school that doesn't enforce it. And what we know is the School Reform Act in the District of Columbia is what created the Charter School Board. And what the charter school world says is, hey, you know what? We're not like the regular public school. We have autonomy. We can do what we want. We can regulate ourselves. We can make independent decisions on laws that are in the District of Columbia. And what we find out in Stormaya's case is when adults decide to interpret the law the way they want to, children suffer.
Mm. So the interesting thing about this is I was looking at this is you were actually involved in creating some of those laws
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
that said if you're in a school must do these things because mm-hmm. we have this huge problem
yep.
of children within this age group mm-hmm. that basically a lot because of despair, economic
yep.
despair,
yep. Yeah.
end up committing suicide along with a lot of other factors, but economic despair is certainly one of them. So you helped author that. then all of a sudden, for some reason, the charter schools think that they're above the law. I don't get that.
They just believe that autonomy means that they can make their own independent decisions, and so that they don't have to follow the law. And we're very clear. Councilmember David Grosso introduced the legislation. I was very fortunate to support the legislation that said, because of the rising number of suicides among African-American middle school-aged children, we're going to require that teachers and staff members have suicide prevention training so that we can prevent children from committing suicide. And not only did the school not do the training, but the authorizer who funds the school said, you know what? It's okay. It's put it over there in the pile. We don't care if you enforce the law. And unfortunately, today we're standing with the loss of life of an amazing young lady.
Yeah. And she was amazing.
Yep.
Yeah. I want to follow this story as it goes on. As your trial gets closer, let's do the story again. Let's see whether the seed organization, the charter school organization, owns up to what they've done here. Thank you for joining
me. No problem. Thank you.
In a landmark victory for marijuana reform, the House of Representatives has passed the Secure Fair Enforcement Banking Act. While the debate over marijuana legalization has flooded state legislators, this banking bill's passage could be paving the way for future federal reforms, we hope. Legal journalist Mollye Barrows joins us now to talk about that. Mollye, when was this bill introduced, and does it seem to be moving at a decent rate?
It does. When so little moves with bipartisan support in Congress now, this one really has a lot of support. So it was proposed in March, and it's moving right along. The House just passed it recently, in fact, and it was proposed by a congressman out of Colorado. And it's basically a law. If it's made law, it will protect any businesses that work with cannabis. It will enable them to be able to work safely with banking institutions, and it will keep these banking institutions from being open to prosecution, any kind of criminal prosecution for doing business with them, because as you know, it's still illegal federally, but we have 33 states and counting, plus the District of Columbia, that have legalized it for state use and individual use. So this is what it's meant to do. There's so much money being made, and basically Congress is saying, this isn't about, or the House anyway, this isn't about marijuana, this is about banking, and these banking institutions are asking for this. So let's give it to them.
Anytime you talk to Congress about banking or Wall Street, they're always going to be favorable.
Yes.
Full disclosure, as I tell this story, Charlotte's Web is something that I want a fair amount of, okay? And so I want to tell you that the problem is when a state says, we're going to legalize this, and then they don't have anything that they can do with the money. Everything's cash. Their credit cards there's some companies that have moved into that space, but it's not broad enough. How is cannabis industry, have they been operating without banking's help?
You said it. It's a lot of cash. It's individual niche businesses that help them problem solve, help them find financiers, if you will. Sometimes it's overseas banks or institutions that are more comfortable with it. Sometimes it's credit unions or locally owned banks, state banks that aren't underneath the same pressures or feeling the same constraints as maybe a national banking institution. Yeah, so it's more the individuals.
I got to tell this story because it's to me, it puts it in perspective. HSBC.
Yes.
We did the story
on
them laundering money for terrorists. Okay.
Well,
and they actually admitted it. Yes, we laundered money for terrorists and human life was taken. Americans were killed because of our laundering money for terrorists. That's an institution that says, we can't do this, though. We certainly can't get involved with marijuana. What's your reaction to this? Isn't this kind of the norm?
Money, money, money.
Yeah,
I think
they
finally got support from the Republicans because Democrats have typically been on board with this. They've typically been supportive of marijuana as an alternative for medicinal treatment, as well as a business proposition. And I think finally you've got the banking institution as a whole on board with legalizing this because there's so much money to be made. And that's where you're getting the support from the Republicans because they are worried, again, going back to that far right stance of maybe offending some of their more conservative or religious constituents, if you will, who may see something wrong because it's still illegal federally. But they want to move forward because they see a chance to make it about banking and not about marijuana. So that's why it went through the House.
Yeah. So where were these religious conservatives when HSBC raised their right hand and said, yes, we have taken in money from terrorists.
That's right.
We knew what we were doing. We understood it was being used to kill American soldiers over in Iraq.
Hypocritical.
And we did it anyway in Afghanistan. And it wasn't just HSBC, by the way. So, okay, does this, let's look at this. If this bill passes, doesn't it also create a trend where more states say, yeah, we're comfortable legalizing this because the federal government finally has shown some leadership and said banking can be involved.
Yes, and I think there's a lot that's at stake here. I mean, first of all, we don't know how well it's going to do in the Senate, but so far reports indicate that they're going to green light that. The fellow from Idaho who is in charge of the Senate Banking Committee, he said that he is definitely going to move it forward. Their version may not look exactly like the House's version, but they do want to take it up. You have Marco Rubio saying, while I may not agree with legalizing marijuana as a whole, I do agree with basically giving banks the green light to go ahead and control it financially so that they have some control. So that, to me, seems to be the heart of it. Whether Rubio meant to say it or not, he was basically saying, we want to put our hands in that cookie jar. By golly, this is how we're going to do
Rubio's
it. And still feel good about ourselves, you know?
Well, Rand Paul, what I love to see, Rand Paul is libertarian, and he says, look, well, let's own up to where this American culture is. Legalized marijuana is a reality.
At least,
for medical use, most people are going to go with that. It's a reality. So let's jump in and own up to reality. Thank you for joining me, okay?
Thanks, Pat.
Yeah. And finally tonight, some good news. On Monday, California Governor Gavin Newsom signed a bill that's going to allow college athletes in the state to receive endorsement deals and to earn the proceeds from the use of their likeness and their names. For years, the NCAA has been fighting efforts to prevent college athletes from being paid for their talents, even though the organization has pulled in more than $1 billion from college athletes only in 2017 alone. These young athletes have been exploited by both the NCAA and the colleges that they attend to pack stadiums, sell jerseys, and even as recruiting tools to attract new students. Meanwhile, these athletes have been barred from ever taking a single dime while the corporate executives rake in billions. These athletes have been putting their bodies on the line during every competition, risking injuries that could ruin any earning potential they might have as professionals. And now, at least in California, these student athletes will finally be allowed to share in some of the financial success that the NCAA has been hoarding for itself way too long. That's all for tonight. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/RT, America's Lawyer. Also, follow us on Twitter at America's Lawyer. You can watch all RT America programs on DirecTV at 321. And stream them live on youtube.com/RT America. I'm Mike Papantonio, and this is America's Lawyer, where every week we tell you the stories that corporate media is ordered not to tell you because their advertisers won't let them. Have a great night. This is an important message for our nation's veterans. If you served our country in the military between 2003 and 2015 and you suffered significant hearing loss, you might be entitled to compensation because the hearing protection you were issued may be at fault for the damage you suffered, but you need to act now. Your time to make a claim might be limited. Learn more at levinlaw.com/earplugs.